Today's special bonus episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Citrix GoToMeeting. Sign up for GoToMeeting by October 10th and get another Citrix product free for 6 months.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
Hey everybody, welcome to This Week in Startups. It's me, your host, Jason Calacanis, and I am sitting here in WeWork's facility in the Tenderloin. Yes, we're explorers. We come to this new area where Twitter and Zendesk all work and pioneering great, beautiful WeWork space. But the mezzanine, people don't know this, is Silicon Valley Bank's mezzanine, and they have a gorgeous mezzanine, as you can see. I do this, and what happens is Jacob cuts the video to show all the different aspects of how cool it is. That's my magic. Do a sweeping view of everything. And so, hey, thanks to my friends at WeWork and Silicon Valley Bank. Both of those entities filled with great people, have been super supportive of me and my career for years. Silicon Valley Bank for 20 years, and WeWork's only existed for a couple years, but boy, have they been supportive. So thanks to my friends there. All right, so I got an email. Singularity University students want to talk to me. Why they want to talk to me, I don't know. But anytime a group of students asks me to meet with them, to speak with them, if I can do it, I say yes. Because you know what happens is you never know. Somebody from that group, maybe the next Travis, or they may be the next Josh Williams, or the next Ryan Block, or Peter Rojas, or Brian Alvey, or Jackie from Red Tricycle, or who knows? Some great entrepreneur that I might at some point angel invest in. And so my number one rule, as you guys know, who listen to the program, is you don't underestimate anybody. You don't sleep on anybody, because nobody in this industry knows who's going to be the next big thing. And my job as an angel investor is to find the next big thing. And I've got to suspend disbelief and make sure that all of those new people, new fresh minds, fall in love with the idea of me angel investing in their company. Let's be frank. I have to have all of you think there's no better angel investor on the planet. And you know what? I'm up against Ron Conway, who's in the room back here with a group of people. That guy's got a track record second to none. And then there's Chris Sacca, and there's Dave Morin, and there's Cyan and Scott Bannister. I mean, there's a lot of great angel investors out there. If I'm going to be number one, I got a lot of work to do. All right. So one of you is in charge. You asked me to speak to this group. Pick up the microphone here. It's open mic night. So who are you, and what question do you have for me? Why am I here?
So I'm Francisco from Spain.
From Spain?
Yes. Welcome. I live in Italy, though, for 12 years already.
Oh, rough life. So yeah. You're from Spain, and then you decided to go to Italy.
Yeah.
We all hate you right now. Go ahead. No. So you went from a place that has the second best food in the world and the best people in the world to the place with the best food in the world and the second best people in the world.
Yes, I guess my wife would agree with you. Yeah. I think the order is inverse, but...
all right, listen, it's okay. Something we can all debate, but...
we can debate
two of my favorite places, yes, Italy and Spain.
Well, I'm an entrepreneur back in Italy, and I started angel investing 5 years ago.
Okay.
I still don't have any great success story to tell, but okay. Things are going okay.
Well, you've invested in 5 companies, you said?
Yes.
All right, so you have to add a 0, and then you'll be successful. Just 1 0. When Maybe. You invest in 50, then you have a chance to have a great return on one of them, 100x return.
I hope I get something earlier so I can really get to 50 investing.
All right. Well, there you go. So then, you know what? You're like, you're going to be super motivated because the odds are against you. And you know what? I play my best poker when I'm down. The best poker I've ever played in my life is when I'm down 50 dimes and I'm pissed off. And I'm angry and I'm losing. And there's nothing better as a poker player to come back from a loss to even. If you make 50 dimes in high stakes poker, it's like, okay, that's supposed to happen. But if you lose 50 dimes and then you magically come back to 0, that is a better feeling. It's interesting. Okay. Anyway, so you have a question for me. You wanted to meet with me for some reason. What the fuck is that? Oh, I'm sorry. What the heck is Singularity University, by the way? I don't think anybody knows what that is. Well, explain what that is in a sentence.
We're still trying to fully understand it.
Okay, explain it in a sentence. What is Singularity University?
Singularity, it's an institution which is exploring how, what they call exponential technologies, which are technologies.
Exponential technologies.
Exponential is a keyword when we are there.
Exponential technologies. Okay, what does that mean? Say it in English.
Well, it means... technologies that are about to take off that we have been giving for deceptive for some time. We wrote them off.
What's an example? Give me an example of an exponential
printing,
technology.
3D printing, for instance.
3D printing.
Yeah. Right.
So you believe that that is going to have some exponential growth or impact on society.
Yeah. Artificial intelligence, for instance.
I agree with the 3D printing. And the only reason I agree, you know why? Because I saw somebody printing Nutella and chocolate with a 3D printer. If you can print 3D Nutella, chocolate, peanut butter, Reese's peanut butter cups that are like in... Like if you can make me a Reese's peanut butter cup that is in the shape of like Boba Fett, then I will believe, because I would pay $20 for a Boba Fett like made of chocolate with peanut butter inside. But everybody's got their own thing, right? Now,
it's been there for 30 years. We can print Nutella only today. So that's what we mean. You know,
yes.
It's about to take off.
The moment they're going to be getting like pieces of toast with Nutella designs on it that are going to be amazing.
Exactly.
It's going to be awesome. We have a bright future. All right. So let's go questions. What questions do you guys have?
So since I've a young angel investor, been following your blog, my question is, how do you expect angel.co and the angel syndicates to transform the VC industry, for instance?
Okay, this is a wonderful question. How will AngelList syndicates and other syndicates, because AngelList isn't the only one doing syndicates, there are other companies. I think Funders Club is one, Crowdfunder is another, MicroVentures is another, Circle Up, which is for local businesses, is another, Slated is another for movies. So there's going to be a bunch of these. But AngelList, I believe that Naval and Nivi are the most talented, who have the biggest vision, and who are executing at the highest level. So they're going to win everything. They'll be the Google of the space. But there'll be a Yahoo and a Twitter and a Facebook and other verticals that will do just fine as well. So what is a syndicate? A syndicate is a bunch of accredited investors, people who have a certain amount of net worth, a couple million bucks, and a certain amount of every year income, $250,000 or $500,000. I don't know the exact number. Anyway, what you can do in a place like AngelList, for people who don't know, is you could say, hey, would 100 of you, 99 of you technically, like to form an LLC, a limited liability corporation, that then goes and invests in a company that the syndicate lead, the angel, picked. So if all y'all have no experience in angel investing, or you live in Florida or Spain, or actually I don't think you can be outside the country yet, but if you lived in Florida or Texas and New York and Chicago and Boston and you didn't have access to the deal flow that maybe I have, or Dave Morin or Gil Pancina has, you could say, hey, or Cyan Bannister, I will invest alongside those famous angel investors and I'll give them 20% of the carry. So if the investment, you know, of my $10,000 becomes $110,000, I'll give $20,000 of it to the person who picked the company. I'll take the $80,000, which would be a 10x return, which would be wonderful, or 11x return, whatever it is. So 2 years ago, I'll take it back even 3 or 4 years ago, people hated Naval. A lot of people hated Naval because they thought what he was doing in circulating angel deals on an email list to other angel investors was disruptive, and they were right. And then there was this guy, Bryce, from AlphaTech Ventures, or Riley AlphaTech Ventures, who said, I'm deleting my profile. This is not the way angel investing should work. And he's a really nice guy. But he was very threatened, I think, by the fact that everybody saw every deal. It was democratized. So any of us could then look at the deal and say, hey, I'll invest. And so the secret was out. Who are the companies raising money? Oh, my God. Everybody's going to know those companies. I don't care about that because I'm secure in my position. But other people might be less secure in their position. I'm not saying Bryce is, less secure. But he might be less secure. I don't know. But he didn't like it. Now it's the standard. People who are raising money all want to have an AngelList syndicate. Why do they want it? I asked them, why do you guys want to do the syndicate? Why do you want to have 99 investors instead of, 99 investors for $400,000, 4,000 on average, instead of 8 investors at 50K each? And they say two things. Number one, I want you, Jason, or I want you, Gil, or I want you, Cyan. And the fact that instead of those three people writing $25,000 or $50,000 checks, they can now write a $450,000 check or $1 million check even, that's really spectacular to the founders because they really want to work with Gil or Cyan or Tim Ferriss. That's their dream angel. But previously, their dream angels would then introduce them to their nightmare VCs, right? The people, the VCs who were maybe, you know, a little more cutthroat, or maybe they didn't really want to have a VC in that early, because VC funds have different motivations and goals than angel investors. And they're not necessarily bad. I mean, I have the world's greatest venture capital firm, Sequoia, is backed inside.com. And I have a lot of friends who work at these great venture firms. Venture firms are fantastic, but they do come with their own set of dynamics. The number one dynamic is they are investing OPM, other people's money. And those other people are looking for a return. And then you're in a basket of companies. In that basket, there are dynamics. So let's say this fund has never returned anything, and they have a chance at a return that's early, they might push the founder to sell early. Let's say they have, the fund has done well and they're already in the black and they're already all rich, which is sometimes the case. They may look at a company and say, you know what, you've got an offer for $300 million to buy your company, and this is a real situation. They said, you know what, $300 million is too little. We're going to go for $1 billion or $3 billion. And the founders were like, well, we don't want to, we want to sell because we're each going to make, you know, $50 million each. We want to sell. And they didn't let them sell. And then the company wound up shutting down and collapsing. So the VC's motivation might be to go long or to go short, depending on the situation. As an angel investor, typically, because we're putting small amounts to work and we're doing it with our own money, well, we're kind of chill. So I put $250,000 into a company called Swell 5 months ago, and they got sold to Apple. And I'm going to make a nice return in 5 months, a return that anybody who was investing in the stock market would be thrilled with. But for me, it was heartbreaking in a way, because I thought that company could go to $1 billion and that I would make 50 or 100 or 200 times the 250 I put in. But for me, I'm just happy for the team that they sold to Apple, probably the greatest technology company alive today. You know, like Apple and Google, people could debate which one's the better one, but... So I'm just happy for the team, and the team, oh wow, they made a lot of money and they get to work for Apple. So I have to be happy for them. A venture firm, they might be very upset by this. And so that's the dynamic. And I think it will change the early stage funding landscape. It already is, because I used to put 50K into three companies a month. So 150K to work, sometimes a little more, sometimes 250, sometimes 50. And Bryce would do all this, who I introduced you guys to before, Bryce, who runs the launch fund for me. But now we put in 50 and then 400 comes behind it. So we're putting more like 1.2 million, 1.5 million to work every month. We're going to put probably $10 to $15 million to work a year instead of 2 million. So this has made me five, six, seven times more effective and large than I used to be. And I don't think it's going to stop.
Hey everybody, it's Jason Calacanis, and as you know, I am a huge fan of Citrix GoToMeeting. I use it every week. I do about 15 meetings a week on it because it's stable, it's fast, it's easy to use, and it's flawless. And I need meetings to start on time, and I need to do the screen switching, and I need people to be on mobile, and it's perfect, okay? GoToMeeting's perfect. You know that. I use it. If anybody have had a meeting with me, you know I don't let you set it up with some free service. That's going to break. I make you use GoToMeeting, and I use my own account, and everything starts on time because I have a limited amount of time. I have a hard stop when I start these meetings, and GoToMeeting lets me have a hard start and a hard stop, and that is critical for me. And good communication is crucial for any business, especially when people you work with now are not in the same office, and it's really expensive to travel right now. Since the recovery, travel has gotten so expensive. It's thousands of dollars. It's a waste of money in most cases. And so sign up for GoToMeeting right now and you're going to get a special offer. It's really cool. If you go to GoToMeeting.com and you sign up for GoToMeeting before October 10th, you're going to get another Citrix products of your choice for free for 6 months. That's right. Two for one. And as you know, it's got HD video conferencing and it's flawless. Whatever they're doing on the back end with the cloud computing and the bandwidth and everything at GoToMeeting, it's flawless. I've had like literally five people in HD and sharing a high-res screen. Perfect, flawless, no hiccups. And, you know, it's just super important to work smarter. So go ahead and get started with GoToMeeting now. And again, the call to action is very clear. You just sign up for GoToMeeting today and you'll get another Citrix tool for free for 6 months. Visit GoToMeeting.com and get started right now. But don't wait. The special offer is going to end on October 10th. That's right. I love the product. I use the product. And I only allow people to be partners on This Week in Startups if we actually love and use their product. And GoToMeeting is one of those products that's been in my toolkit as a founder, as an angel investor for years. So please go to GoToMeeting.com and get that special offer, another Citrix tool for free for 6 months. But you have to do it by October 10th. All right, let's get back to this amazing episode.
If I can ask a follow-up question.
Yes.
What's your prediction? How big, say, in 2014, what's going to be the biggest syndicate?
Well, in 2014, we already have a number of people have multi-million dollar syndicates. So my syndicate's $1.5 million. Tim Ferriss's might be three. I think Gill's is three. There is a limit on the number of people who can be involved. So the truth is, I have 400 people in my syndicate, only 403 people as of this morning. Only 99 of them can do each deal. So because of that limit, I think it's naturally capped at even if every person in the syndicate put in $5,000, it would be 500. If everybody put in 10, it'd be a million. So I think it will probably wind up being that these syndicates will be able to do $1 million at capacity. And I think right now I'm doing 200 to 400. And I think in the coming months, you'll see mine do 400 to 600, and then maybe next year, 600 to 800 or a million eventually. But I don't want to have it become a big boy game and a big girl game where it's only $10,000 to participate. I want people to be able to participate at the $2,500 level and even the $1,000 level. So that's one of the dynamics I'm trying to figure out is what's the sweet spot.
And how much should the lead syndicator put of the total amount?
Yeah, so I usually put in 25 to 50, and then people follow on with 200, 400. So I think, you know, because each individual is making their own decision and I let them opt out, I think they should be less worried about how much I'm putting in. Even if I didn't put any in, I would still think people should back me. I know that sounds crazy because I wouldn't be putting skin in the game, but I would still have the carry. So I guess that speaks to how reckless will the syndicate leads be? Like, will they take a lot of risk? Well, you know what? You want to take risk in angel investing. And the thing that most people do wrong in angel investing is they really put a lot of money into the ideas they think are going to work, and they put a little bit of money into the ideas they think don't have a major chance of working, and then they ignore the ones that are extremely risky. I do the opposite. I put a lot of money into the most risky ones, and I put less money into the ones that are obvious. In fact, I don't invest in the obvious ones because I want to lose my money 7 out of 10 times. If the idea is not so crazy that I'm going to lose my money 70% of the time, it's why am I doing it? That's not angel investing. That's mutual fund investing. You could go invest in Google or Apple and get those kind of more secure returns. I mean, if you invest in Apple or Google right now, you will be ahead in 10 years. That's guaranteed. So I like risk.
Hi, my name is Jelte, based in Amsterdam. I do an edtech startup that I started in the MIT Media Lab 2 years ago. Question also, follow-up question. How is this changing the dynamics of you as an angel investor? I mean, part of going to work with an angel investor is you like the person.
Yeah.
But if you're spreading your time and your attention to many more startups, obviously you're not able to be as mentory. You're going to be much more hands-off, just if you do the maths. But perhaps you have an approach that will actually allow you to work that personal with
new ventures. It's a good question. I'm on the same pace for investing. I'm just going deeper, right? So I was always going to do two or three a month, 25 a year at 50K to 250K each with my fund. I have a launch fund that's $10 million. And so I'm just offering to the angel syndicate if they want to participate as well. And sometimes they syndicate in one deal, they syndicated only 200, 250. And in other deals, if they really like it, they syndicate 400. So it's really up to them how much they want to. And there'll become a time when I'll syndicate something and it won't hit the 200 minimum. I think that could happen. And it hasn't happened yet, but we've been close where people said like, I don't know if I want to invest in that company. It seems too speculative. That's fine. But for me, as an angel investor, I've built a platform. And most people don't know about my platform, but I'll reveal it today. For the first time, I have 9 full-time people who work for the Launch Foundation, which is the foundation. It's not a nonprofit. It's a for break-even. And what this for break-even does is it does the Launch Festival, which is the largest startup event in the world. 9,000 people last year, 12,000 people will come this year at Fort Mason, March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. Correct me if I'm wrong, somebody. March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th for the festival. Yes. So I do that festival every year. I allow 90% of the people to come for free. 10% pay for tickets and a bunch of great sponsors do that. Excuse me, because I have that event, my deal flow is huge. People apply to come to that event. So we see the best stuff. Then the nine people who work for my company, the foundation, all review those companies and tell me these are the best. And I have a podcast called This Week in Startups. We do 100 episodes a year. My team, my full-time producer, Jackie, who's won Emmy Awards, she looks at all the companies that the rest of the team is looking at and says, this one would be great for the show. So I naturally meet 100 people a year, 150 people a year probably, who have been on the show who are really good. And I've spent an hour talking to them about their vision. Huge advantage. And then those shows go out to 100,000 people who then get inspired to do their own startup. And then the first thing they do is say, if I'm going to do a startup, I should email Jason because my pal Jason does This Week in Startups. And I was inspired by him to do a startup. And that happened with Product Hunt, which just launched at Y Combinator and was on the show. But the person who was running it was a super fan of the thing. Now, in that case, he didn't actually invite me to angel invest. So maybe my system's broken. But I've made him feel really bad about not inviting me to angel invest, and now he's definitely going to invite me the next time. But putting that aside, in addition to that, we have somebody who picks who's going to be on stage for speaking gigs at my events. They're constantly looking at companies. So my team is looking every week at probably 100 to 200 companies, meeting with them, and exploring what they're doing. And then they feed them to me, and then I go meet with them. So I have a whole system. Then once I've invested in a company, they can come back on This Week in Startups, or they could be a guest on the news roundtable, or they could be a judge at the event, or they could speak at my event. So I can find them through the funnel, and then I could project them back out through that same funnel. I can feature them and say, hey, I invested in this company. So when I invested in Swell, the $250,000, I wrote a LinkedIn post and a Medium post why I invested $250,000 in Swell, and I outlined it. Now I look like a genius, because it got bought by Apple 5 months later. And people probably think, oh, somebody at Apple probably read that post. That's not true, but people might think that, and that's fine. And so I helped Swell get their, I probably helped Swell get their first, let's say, 10,000 users. So they probably got 50,000 or 100,000 users in the first couple of months. I don't know exactly the numbers, I'm making it up. But I'm sure me tweeting about it and writing about it, because I reach hundreds of thousands of people with my podcast and my email, that probably helped them get those first 10,000. So what I try to do when I talk to founders is, yeah, I'll help you get the first couple of thousand people to your product. You know what? That's the hardest thing to get. And so as I build my loyalty up from my super fans and the fans of the festival, I actually build up a reserve of people who can then use your ad network. And so I have a huge advantage over other angels. And that's why someday I'll be the number one angel. Right now, I'm probably number 10. Maybe number 7. I would say I'm between 7 and 10. There's definitely 6 or 7 people who are much better than me at angel investing. But I've only been at it a couple years. And in another 2 years, 3 years, I'll be in the top 3. And then after that, it'll be a dogfight to see who gets number 1. But 5, 6 years from now, I should be number 1 or number 2. And if I'm not, I'm going to be very, very upset at the people who work for me for not getting me there. No, we're all going to get there together, but that's the goal. You don't have to have goals in life. Go ahead, next question.
So from my understanding, some of the best deals are highly competitive. So you got some of the best early stage funds, some of the best angels are competing.
That's right.
A slot on that deal.
That's right.
So when you spot one of those deals.
Oh my God, is the bomb going off?
No, it's my car. I need to put more coins for the parking. But
all right, ask the question, I'll answer it. Ask the question, then I'll run downstairs, I'll think about it, put some cash in your meter.
So on those deals, let's say perhaps you get the chance to get a 100K slot in it.
Yeah.
Would you share it on AngelList?
Right, good question. So you guys are obsessed with the AngelList thing, interesting.
AngelList or would you share it?
So here's what happens. There sometimes deals are what's called oversubscribed. More people want to invest. Now, that typically doesn't affect me. Why? Because most people want me involved and I'm not taking a huge chunk. So I'm happy to put 25K or even 10K into a deal as I am to put 250. If I put $500,000 into a deal or I put $50,000, I'm going to behave the same. I'm going to put the same amount of effort. Once I put any money and my name on a deal, I'm going to fight with that founder and that founding team to win till the last moment, till the lights go off, I will be there for that team.
Yeah, now, if you only have 50, if there's only 50K available,
then
for yourself,
I can't syndicate
it.
But I can't syndicate it. So the syndication is up to the founder. I say to the founders, sure, I'd love to put 50K in. So for example, a very famous founder allowed me to invest. I said, I'll put 250 in. So the launch fund's going to put 250K in. And I said, hey, whatever else, oh, I'm going to tell them this afternoon, would you like me also to syndicate it or not? It's up to the founder. Some founders don't want to do that process. Some founders don't want to have the other 100 investors. Some do. So I leave it up to them. It's not my choice. It's the founder's choice.
Would you say that the best deals never get the chance, never get to AngelList and like to...
No.
To
the most, they never. No, the best ones get there.
They get there?
In my experience so far, everybody wants the best angel investors to take as much as possible because they'd rather deal with the best angel investors, not the venture firms and their partnerships. So one of the problems with a venture firm is you have to get 10 partners to agree or 5 partners to agree typically, and it will take you 2 meetings with the venture capitalist to prepare, if they like it, to go present to the whole partnership 1, 2, or 3 times. And then you have to debate the terms. So you're talking about maybe at least 4 or 5 meetings with a venture firm to close a deal and a month. And if they're super motivated, they might do this and compress it down to 2 weeks. And if you had multiple term sheets, they might do it in a week and 3 or 4 meetings. But having been through this, you typically meet with 10 venture capital firms, 15, maybe 15 of them. You do follow-up meetings with half, and then you go to the whole partnership with 2 or 3. And then you probably get term sheets from 2 of those, right? Maybe go to the whole partnership with 4, and then you get 2 term sheets or 3, depending on how good your company is and your pitch and how much they want it. It's exhausting. What if you could just go to me and I gave you $1 million? Well, that's where it's going. Because I make decisions. Bryce will tell you because he comes to all my meetings. I can look in your eyes. I can just look. You tell me what you're doing, and I can just tell if you're going to win or not. I have a superpower. I'm like a mutant. You know Professor X? You know, he puts Cerebro on and he can see all the other mutants. I have my own Cerebro. I put it on. I can see all the founders that are going to win because I've won. I know what it takes to win. And all my friends are winners. And I've seen it over and over again as a journalist, as an investor, on the podcast, at the shows. I have a mutant power. When people start talking, I immediately see their life 10 years from now. I see them with 500 people working for them. And ringing the bell at the NASDAQ or buying a company or raising. I see the headlines. I see the lobby of their building. I see the building they've built. It just all comes to me in a vision. Or I see them in the background of those 500 people. And I say, you know what? I can just tell looking at you like you're the person in the front. Or I can tell looking at you, no offense, like you're the guy in the back or the side. You're the guy next to the guy or the gal next to the guy, you know? You're not the gal in the front. You're the one who's like next to them as the CFO or the director. There's nothing wrong with that, but I can just tell that company's going to make it, and I see that founder winning. I just see it. And you know what? GoWalla was one of my first investments as an angel investor, and I lost my money. I'm still waiting to get my Facebook shares. They're like locked up in some, you know, committee or something. But the founder, I told Josh Williams, who founded it, like, I think you're I think you're the most talented mobile designer ever. Like, I've never seen anybody design such beautiful product as GoWalla. It was like the Foursquare competitor. And everybody at that time would look and say, my God, Foursquare is so ugly and the user interface is so clunky and GoWalla is so buttery and smooth and delicious and awesome. And Foursquare won through iteration and GoWalla is no more. But I told that founder, listen, I see it in my mind. I see his success. And it doesn't have to be at this company. So I told him, when you get out of Facebook, I want to be the first angel in your next company. So he texted me, hey, Jason, tomorrow's my last day at Facebook. And you know what I said to him? Tell me where to send the check. And he said, do you want to know the idea? And you know what I said to him? No. Let me send the check first. Bryce can tell you the story. I'll sign the paper. I'll send you the check. And then we'll talk about the idea. Because I know. I could look in his eyes, Josh Williams' eyes, Eye of the Tiger. And everybody's like, oh, GoWalla's a failure. No. GoWalla was the milestone, the stepping point. That was his waypoint to what will be his ultimate success in the next company. And if not that company, that company's the waypoint to the ultimate success. I'll back him 3, 4, 5 times. Just like I back Travis 10 times. Just like I back Kevin Rose 10 times. I back Dave Morin 10 times. There's some people I would just back forever. That's like... placing a bet on like Michael Jordan or LeBron James to like win a championship. Of course, you make that bet every year if it's even money. Next question.
So if we take the other point of view, more in the startup side and a founder of anyone who wants to respond.
By the way, that's the only point I take. That is the only, my point of view is not as an angel investor.
Cool.
That's why I think I'll be very successful as an angel investor. So I don't think like an investor. I think like a founder.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So the question is like, as a founder, how does a founder decide which angel to go for or which who he wants to go for? And because you're telling that some angels are better or how,
if
how
you're,
does it take,
so
what
if
does
you,
it take to be better?
Yeah. So if you're a founder should make a decision as to which investor she wants based upon the reputation and value that investor brings. It's very easy to determine the reputation of an investor. You call the founders of the companies they've invested in, especially the ones that have failed or exited already, and you say, I'm talking to Jason or Cyan or Scott Bannister or whoever about taking an angel investment from them. I was wondering if I could talk to you about your experience with them as an investor. And if you get anything other than this is the greatest angel investor ever, they've been super supportive, you should absolutely do it. If you get anything other than that immediately back from the person within 24 or 48 hours, then you should not have them as an investor. The problem is most people are so desperate for money that they don't do that. And they just take money from whoever they can get it from. And that's the huge mistake. But I understand it as a founder myself. You need money. Sometimes you got to take money. So, you know, sometimes you don't have the choice. If you have the choice, it's very simple. Just call up their founders. And you'd be surprised how many people don't do it. And then there's the opposite. As an angel investor, I have Bryce call all of the previous companies. And we do reference checks. We check on where you worked before, who you worked with, what people think of you. You know, who else has invested in you? And we don't tell you we're doing it. We just do it. You don't know who we're calling to check on you. And if we know you had a deal go bad, we're talking on that person especially. So if you had a company that went bad and there was a lawsuit, we're definitely calling those people. We want to find out what happened. We want to hear them slander you on the phone. And you know what? That doesn't mean we're not going to invest either, because business can be messy. And the best people to invest in sometimes are the ones who are the most persnickety, difficult. Like, you want difficult people. Let me tell you, like, I don't think anybody is sitting here thinking for a minute that anybody who made one of the great companies, Steve Jobs, Elon Musk, Evan Williams, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, these are difficult people, I'm sure, at times. I would not expect that being on the other side of the negotiating table or being a senior manager working for those people, you would not recount stories that were tremendously intense, because they've built great things. Great things are only built through massive intensity, right? That diamond is the process. Building a diamond is the process of applying pressure. You know how much pressure had to be applied to make Tesla or SpaceX or Twitter? Like, it's a lot of pressure was applied to that diamond, or that piece of coal or carbon that became diamond, or there's a lot of itchiness in that oyster that that sand turned into a pearl. I could just keep going on the metaphors. You guys got to tell me if you get it. You guys get it. Go ahead.
I had a question. We're at Singularity University, and as we mentioned before, exponential technologies. And one of the tasks we have is find businesses or ideas that address the larger challenges we as mankind face. So a lot of the ideas and businesses we came up with are not probably immediately transferable, but they're more moonshooting, like probably fall into the category you mentioned, the very risky business.
Yeah.
So what would we as a starter need to do to come on the radar screen of your nine or of your excellent team?
Yeah.
And how would we actually have to formulate the idea to not look sound too fictitious, but basically something that actually, you know, probably can get reality in 5 or 10 years?
Yeah. So listen, if you're pitching the moon base on Mars, the human base on Mars, like, that's a crazy pitch. But that's not the pitch Elon Musk went to NASA with, or anybody else putting up satellites. He said, I can put up satellites cheaper. And then when he talked to the press, they said, why are you doing it? What motivates you? And he said, well, I want to back up the biosphere. And I want to be the first one to Mars. But he told the people who wanted to put the satellites up, I'm going to make reusable rockets, and I'm going to do it for half price, a third of the price of what you're paying now. And they were like, yeah, do it. We're here, you know? And then he told a bunch of rich people with Tesla, hey, you can buy this supercar called the Roadster for $130,000. It's made of carbon fiber, and it goes 0 to 60 in under 3.5 seconds, and you'll be the first person who has a fully EV car because there's no EV cars on the road today. And he sold 2,000 of us knuckleheads on having a ridiculously expensive go-kart that went ridiculously fast when there were no charging stations in the world. He got us. We paid in advance. We believed in the vision. And he only needed to get 2,000 people to believe in that vision. God bless him. He did it. And he put all his own money to work. And then he sold everybody on the next vision, which was, hey, I could make a sedan that goes 300 miles for 80 grand. That'll be the fastest, most beautiful, high-tech car you ever had. And yeah, it's going to be expensive like the first Apple computers were, but boy, is it going to be sexy and awesome. And now he's selling the rest of society on the $35,000 car, the Gen 3. That'll be awesome as well. So he did the S, he did the X, and now he's doing the E, or the 3. He's doing the SEX, three models. The 3 turned backwards is an S. The 3 is an E. Anyway, putting all that aside, the point is you have to show like, hey, on the way to putting everybody in the planet onto a giant social graph, we're going to be able to do something else to make money to get us there. So when Zuckerberg came out here with Sean Parker as his guide, who deserves a lot of credit, who doesn't get a lot of credit for it, you know, he was just trying to help you share pictures and get your mom and your cousin, you know, into the social networking world where Friendster and MySpace couldn't, because mom wasn't joining MySpace. It was too clunky and difficult. So it made MySpace easier. It's just a simple, much simpler approach, right? So you have to be able to show that. You have to show like, hey, here's the grand vision, but here's what we're going to do today. I mean, just today, Travis unleashed the Uber API on the world. The Uber API he was talking about from the beginning. All of us were, you know, kept quiet about it, but the Uber API has been the concept since the beginning. Is anybody could put Uber into any application in the world. And so everybody's been taking Uber and saying, hey, how do we make Uber, you know, we'll slice Uber and we'll make an Uber of lawn mowing or an Uber of cleaning your house or whatever. And I think Travis had the vision of let's have an Uber API. Anybody can add Uber to anything for transportation, for logistics. And he launched it today, 4 or 5 years into the Uber story. And I think the Harvard Business Case study, where the study by, Singularity will start with something to the effect of 4 years after piloting their car sharing service, Uber launched the API, which started the growth of the company. So all the growth of the company now, that which people have been crazy about, that's all this. And then the API is going to be that, right? But if he came out and said, I'm going to make an API where you can move anything from anywhere and watch it move on your screens, be like, what are you talking about? He just said, hey, you can get a cab. He took the best use case and did that, right? 3D printers, the same thing. Like, who needs a 3D printer? Okay, industrial designers need a 3D printer. Right, we'll start with them. So you got to just start somewhere, you know? And like, oh, yeah, now 3D printers are easy enough that your kids can start printing out toys. Oh, and Disney's going to make a whole series of models that you can download for a dollar and print yourself. Okay, that's cool. Christmas ornaments. Okay, fun. You know, they made it fun. Now food. Okay, yeah, some chefs might or chocolate stores might start using it. We're starting to get there, right? So I think what they did right at what's the 3D printing company from New York?
MakerBot.
MakerBot. What MakerBot did so well, they've been on the program. What MakerBot did so well was they just went after the hobbyists and the hackers, and then they just started going down the line. They threaded the needle perfectly. You know, $5,000, $3,000, $1,000, $300 machine. You got to figure that out for each company.
Jason, you have your festival, you have more and more accelerator programs, you have Singularity with its own angle to entrepreneurship. Do you think there's a nexus capacity of entrepreneurship education or entrepreneurs encouragement?
There can never be enough. Everybody's got to think entrepreneurial on this planet. So, you know, if literally every single person woke up tomorrow and went to like, you know, any person who's not employed and who's in college, let's put it that way. If we had enough accelerators and incubators for them to go to, that would be a net positive for society. So literally, if you're unemployed, instead of being unemployed, to get your unemployment check, they should send you to an accelerator where you learn entrepreneurship. Because then you could take the people who are in the weakest state, the most vulnerable state, collecting unemployment, and put them into an accelerator. So if I was president, or when I'm president, when you all make me president of the world, that's what I'll do. That's my promise to you. Unemployment will, you'll be able to collect unemployment. In fact, we're going to give you 20% more unemployment. But you have to show up at 7 a.m. and you're leaving at 7 p.m. to an accelerator called the Unemployed Accelerator. And at the Unemployed Accelerator, you will learn how to build a fucking startup and be entrepreneurial. And so no matter if, how much skill you lack, the fact that you want to get that unemployment check, you're going to work 50 hours a week for it. And we're going to give you minimum wage plus 10% to collect unemployment. You cannot be unemployed in Jason's world. If you make me president of the planet Earth, that's how it will work. You won't be unemployed. We'll just tax the rich a little bit more. They can afford it. Polarization of wealth, all that stuff, right? You guys talk about this stuff. Big thinking. Fuck it. Rich people pay 1%, 2% more tax. Just the top like 1% pay another 2%. And then anybody who is unemployed, underemployed, they can just go to an accelerator and start building a business. It's a crazy idea, right?
Interesting. I think we should pilot it.
Maybe
in California before.
I don't have time. That's why I'm investing. I have ADD and I don't have time. I'm going to be dead soon. I'm 43. I'm going to be dead very soon. I got 40 years left on this planet. I got to make an imprint.
You know, we are expanding the amount of years with healthy life.
Yeah, that's what you guys are doing over there at Singularity. This is all the front, right? All this bullshit with the 3D printers, you're just extending life. It's some sort of big cult, right? There's some Illuminati shit going on here.
So, during our time at Singularity...
Is anybody here American or are you all from outside the U.S.? Not one American.
We have a Canadian, if that's worth it.
You're Canadian. That's kind of America, 51st state. You are a lot better, actually. There's a lot of great things about Canadian society, actually, I think. You guys always had a higher minimum wage, right? Better safety net. Yeah, it's great. Actually, Canada's a great country. I mean, it's only 40 million people or something, 35?
30.
It's only 30?
30 million.
It's amazing. Is that less than California?
I have no idea.
How many people in California? Look that up, Jackie. Thank you. I think you have less people than California, but man, people are happy up there. They have a great life, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, we do. Do you invest internationally?
Oh, no.
Why?
Definitely not. Number one, I like to be able to, one, okay, wait. It's like three
you
number
said
ones.
Canadians were great people.
They are great people, but I'm never investing in any Canadian companies, so that's out of the question. Number one, the governments outside the U.S. fuck with the companies too much. And so I don't know the exact regulations in Canada. I know they give a lot of spiffs and they can like help people. But generally speaking, countries that are not America tend to screw up the companies. There's very few places that have really optimized for entrepreneurship. The United States is optimized for entrepreneurship better than any other country in the world. And you see that based on our GDP and the fact that our products are used globally. Find me a product outside the United States that is used in more than 50 countries. Legos. Okay, next. Children's toys, Legos. Okay, great. What's next? Okay, maybe champagne. Okay, sure. Veuve Clicquot, it's Moët. I mean, I don't know. Next. You know, like Fiat cars. Okay, maybe. You know, Mercedes, Skype, right? Like you can come up with some. But then if I did it like within 50 miles of this place where we're standing, Google, Apple, Cisco, Atari. I mean, I could just go down the list from 80s to 90s. It's just the density here of opportunity and the magnitude of the returns have been so high that it would be foolish for an angel investor to do anything other than be here and be investing here. And it would be foolish for anybody who's truly talented to be any other place but here, unless, caveat, they're so good that people will come to them. And so there are cases... Groupon in Chicago, where people would go out to Chicago and make the flight, or in New York, Foursquare, Gilt Group, Etsy and Kickstarter. I mean, there's a number of Tumblr exceptional things in New York and LA, Snapchat, Whisper, Nasty Gal, Maker, Fullscreen. There's a number of exceptional companies there. So it can happen. It just takes an extraordinary individual in that market to overcome. But then even if you were to spend your time there, like Fred Wilson's been tremendously successful in New York, knowing that market for a long time. But Fred Wilson here would have been twice as successful, three times as successful. I guess he doesn't need any more success than he has. But the truth is, he probably would be in the top two or three VCs out here based on how good he is at his job. But he would have definitely done Facebook, Google, and Tumblr. So just on a logical basis, it makes more sense to be here. That being said, I am absolutely more than willing to take a company from any country in the world and an entrepreneur and bring them here, New York or Los Angeles or any other city that is incredibly supportive of entrepreneurship and set them up in business.
Right.
So I met with a company at Y Combinator Demo Day yesterday, and they're doing fascinating stuff in Toronto. And I was like, where's the company headquarters? Toronto. Yeah, we're here every 2 weeks. I don't give a fuck. Move the company. Let's go. Mm-hmm. At a company in Syracuse. They're moving here. I'm investing. And I told them, I was like, listen, guys, you're in Syracuse. Nobody, you're going to be the biggest company in the history of Syracuse. Like, congratulations. That gets you nothing. Like, get out of Syracuse as quick as possible and get into the big leagues. It'd be like an NBA player deciding, like, they want to play in Europe. Like, yeah, you could have a great career in Europe. You could play for the Spanish team and whatever. Or an American who's the greatest soccer player in America playing in America and playing soccer in America. Like, no. Go play for Arsenal. Go play for whoever. Like, there's a league in Europe for soccer where 100,000 people come out and watch games, and then in here in the United States, 3,000 people come out. Like, go play soccer where soccer is played. Go play basketball where basketball is played. Go play entrepreneurship where entrepreneurship is played. That's here in New York and LA.
Have you spent much time in Israel or London? Because they have quite vibrant...
Yeah, I've spent a ton of time in London. I haven't been to Israel. Israel does great. Like, on per capita basis, they're probably the most effective at building, you know, companies worth tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. So, like, whatever, 6-7 million Jewish people there, and they're producing more companies, you know, per capita and more wealth and market cap than many other places. So kudos to them. But there's very indigenous investors there, like Yossi Vardy and I guess Sequoia's over there, they have it locked up. And then London, fantastic as well, except all the people in London, when they find out you're an entrepreneur, are like, oh, you're trying to squeeze people, are you? Oh, yeah, you're trying to get the wool over, put a Mickey on somebody, whatever. It's like, they're so negative about entrepreneurs there. And the same in Paris. It's just like, it's brutal. Mm. Everybody thinks an entrepreneur in London or Paris is trying to, like, do something nefarious. Mm-hmm. They don't celebrate them in those places, I find. Yeah. They're all very negative. They go out to the pub, they get a pint, and everybody's just slagging on them. It's like, I was an entrepreneur and I went out and, like, I'm seeing all my mates in a pub and we're having some chips and a pint, and they're all just like laughing at me as an entrepreneur and giving me a hard time. Like, why am I here? Like, fuck you guys, I'm out. I'm going to go to America where, like, I'm going to get high fives, and I'm going to go, like, hang out at the Battery with Jason and Sokka and Dick Costolo and Kevin Rose and Loic and all these other people and do high fives, right? Like, it's too pessimistic, man. It's too pessimistic. And they're just, like, too down on entrepreneurs. You know, like, if
even the investors are really tough there.
Investors really are, I was gonna say, like,
in London, the UK.
Yeah, I would say 38 million people in California. So we have 8 million more people in California than Toronto, than Canada. Listen, the investors in London and the investors in Europe are generally not real venture investors. More like private equity investors. They don't like risk. They're like too up in the business of the entrepreneurs. They're too pessimistic. They want like small returns. They're too, I'm trying to use a word that connotes like they're not bold risk takers. What's a word that connotes like they're not bold? They're weak. They're timid. Thank you, Jacob. They're timid. They're weak. Like, investors in London, ugh, God almighty. What have they done? Nothing. Nothing. And the best firm index, they all moved here. They moved here for a reason. It's like entrepreneurship over there is like, it's like swimming in oatmeal. Yeah, I mean, listen, you have to have an outpost there. A lot of people like to hang out in London. It's a great town. Like, listen, it's in the top five cities in the world. It's like New York, LA, New York, Paris, Barcelona. Yeah, great. There's going to be opportunities there. Google Ventures is probably there to probably just shut the EU up about all their investigations. Let's be honest. They're just so, I mean, listen, Google is so hammered by the EU. The only people regulating Google's massive expansion right now or throttling it in any way is the EU. And Google's going to go over there. They're going to put hundreds of millions of dollars to work. so that they have the high ground. When you guys start policing them, they're like, oh, but we invested in all these local companies. It's all a PR move, man. Give me a fucking break. What's that? It's PR that pays you back. It's monetized PR. If they invest in 100 companies there and they put $10 million into each and they put $1 billion to work, one of them will become worth $1 billion. And then when everybody starts complaining that Google has 98% market share, all they have to do is say, hey, you know what? We have 98% market share, but we put $1 billion into these 100 companies. And look, these five now employ 100,000 people. So you should really be thankful because we're reinvesting in your community. It's the savviest move ever. Kudos to, I mean, it's great for entrepreneurs too. So like I said, I'm not slagging on Google for doing it, but let's call a spade here. I mean, we know what's going on, don't we? We're just buying off the EU people. I'm probably the only person who has said this ever and will ever say it publicly. But everybody's thinking it, right? What does it say? You can change the Google search results in the EU if you don't like them? I mean, what is that about? It's just an index of pages. Like, who came up with this idea? It's crazy, right? I want to have that page removed. Great. Okay, write a letter to the government. The government will decide what documents can exist in the world. Really? I mean, Europe's bizarre. I mean, it's just some bizarre. I mean, I'm not saying that it's there aren't instances where things should be removed, obviously. Like, if somebody's doing something illegal, they're selling drugs or pedophilia. I mean, there's a lot of things that should be removed from Google Index, and they do. But if I write an article or a blog post, and I'm like, in my experience, like with this person as a business partner, they were a terrible person, and here's why, that person can then go lobby to take it out. Like, it's a weird thing. I mean, listen, Europe's had some weird history too. I mean, there's like, it's very hard for Americans to understand like why you can't sell, you know, like, if somebody was, listen, here we have a very high benchmark for freedom of speech, very high. But in a place where the Holocaust occurred, I could understand like maybe the benchmark for freedom of speech is a little bit more throttled because you saw millions of people die. I guess it's appropriate, you know, like, but here we don't understand like, wait a second, you linked, if I tweeted like, these Nazi skinhead scumbags need to be stopped, and I linked to their site, no big deal. If I did that in Europe, aren't there some places where I would get arrested for linking to the Nazi site? That is the case in France and in Germany, correct? In Germany, definitely. And I think in France, Yahoo. Yeah, and then in Yahoo, you also, well, maybe it's an appropriate reaction in those countries. But in France, I think Yahoo had to deal with people selling like this is a piece of Nazi memorabilia and somebody put it up on their eBay-ish thing and they had to deal with that. So like, you know, there's all these like crazy nuances of operating in each country. And I think that's why entrepreneurship is, you know, very difficult in very evolved societies, because they start thinking about the ramifications of these things and they say like, let's go slower. Slowing things down is the enemy of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship and companies want to go fast and grow quickly. And so we get really weird, crazy things that happen in this country, some of which are not good, you know, like the dot-com bust or the real estate bust, but we seem to weather them. But we have to be careful. There's things to be learned actually from the European market and their approach. Like, I think Google needs to be looked at by the government in the United States much, much more. And I am a free market capitalist if there ever was one. But when a company has the market share that Google has and the amount of money and the amount of ambition, like literally we need to be looking at everything they're doing, like, and just being, hey, you know, you're moving all the search results down and putting all of your stuff atop of it. Wait a second, what exactly is going on here? You know, like, let's get an idea. Oh, because like, in terms of privacy, the information Google has right now, I don't think even people at Google understand how much they have or how much could be put together, because Google is operating so fast and so quickly, like, who knows? Who knows what they're doing? Like, your Android phone is recording a bunch of stuff. You're logged in with your Gmail, you use Maps, your history is saved, you have Nest in your house, we know the temperature, we know that you're in your house, your phone confirms you're in your house, we know when you woke up, we know your average wake-up time, we know what you search for, and that you went past the Nest. Oh, and they bought the security camera company, Dropcam, and they had the satellite company. Like, wait a second. Google has bought a satellite company that can do satellite video of your house so they could see you leave your house. They have Nest in your house. They have Dropcam in your house. They have Android in your pocket. They have your entire search history. Like, Google has to be regulated and investigated at a very deep level to make sure that that information is not being, I mean, the NSA could never design a system that is comprehensive. 10 years ago, the NSA could not design a system as comprehensive as the one that Google has built. Think about that. The NSA could never conceive of a system they could deploy that would be as effective as what as Google has right now. If that is the case, then Google is the most dangerous company on the planet potentially, and Google needs to be investigated deeply. Oh, but yeah, leaving aside the fact that they just did a health extension company or whatever, and that does not mean, by the way, for the record, that anybody at Google has bad intent. I don't believe they do. But they have stumbled upon a system where they have so much information, and they have proven to not be super careful with information before, and they have not behaved very well with their partners before. So there's a long list of people who feel they've been double-crossed by Google, some fairly, some unfairly, right? So if you have people like Yelp who feel like they got double-crossed, or, you know, a ton of other people, well, you might need to keep an eye on this company. And I, you know, if you told me 10 years ago I would be saying we need to regulate Google, I'd be saying, well, who cares? You know, like, just let them do what they're going to do. The market's going to work it out. But I don't think anybody ever anticipated that Larry Page would wake up one day and Sergey, and they'd say, let's take all this money we have, and instead of giving it back to our shareholders, let's do self-driving cars and life extension. Like, if you told me that 10 years ago when they went public, that they're going to be in the life extension, mobile, satellite, and self-driving car businesses, I would tell you, like, are you smoking weed? Like, are you out of your mind? It's a search engine company. How would they ever get from search engine to self-driving cars and satellites and life extension? It's not possible. It's happened. So then where will they be in 10 years with $50 billion in cash and printing another $10 billion in cash or $20 billion in cash every year? We'll see what it turns out to be. I mean, they'll be able to every year deploy tens of billions of dollars into these projects. Nobody's in there ever. The venture capital industry, you know, in all its heft, has never done these kind of bets. It's never existed in humanity.
How do you think that Cooper shoot happened somewhere?
I have no idea. I just know that there's a dialogue. Like, the gentleman asked, how do I think it should be regulated or examined? I don't know. I do know that Google is the worst company at communicating with partners and the government ever. Like, worse than Microsoft. I mean, Larry Page never speaks publicly. He's done like 2 speaking gigs since he's been there. Did like 1 Stephen Levy interview. And he's a great guy. I mean, I know him. He's a great guy, but he needs to be out there talking about what they're doing a lot more. And I think he is. Like, he just spoke at, and he had a terrible thing where he couldn't speak because the vocal thing, from what they said in the press. But he just spoke at the Sun Valley conference to the other leaders, because Google's becoming the most hated company in the world. People don't trust Google. People used to love Google, and now they hate it. And now they don't trust it. And if you talk to anybody in the Valley, at anybody in the media business, they are nervous about that company. They love Apple. They're not nervous about Apple. They love Microsoft. They're rooting for Microsoft now. Google, every media company is, and every media and technology company hates that company. They don't like the executives. They don't trust them. There is a level of mistrust and hatred of Google that is palatable now. And it's a very weird thing, because I'm friends with a lot of those people and I talk to them. And then when they leave the conversation and other people come up, they're just like, whoa, you know, like, are they our enemies, or are they an alien species that has invaded the planet Earth? Like, there is a theory that aliens invaded Earth and it's Googlers and that they're just slowly revealing themselves as being 190 IQ each, with the ability to not sleep and levitate. Like, we're going to just find out one day, like, all the Google people will just be levitating by the windows here, like in Dark City. And I'd be like, oh, they're Googlers. Yeah, they're from the planet, like, Googler. It's like some planet out there, Google are, and they infected society 50 years ago. Anyway, keep going. We've got 1-2 more questions.
Maybe a question. You talked about thinking big and big ideas. What for you maybe are the top 2 or 3 questions that we as a society have to solve upcoming in the next 10, 15 years?
You tell me what you think.
It's a question for you. I'm curious to hear your comments on that.
listen, you're at Singularity University. You guys think about that stuff. You guys listen to all those TED Talks. You go to TED. I don't. I think let me tell you the issues I'm not worried about to start, because I think I'm not worried about global warming. I'm not worried about food supply. I'm not worried about water, and I'm not worried about energy. I'm not worried about cancer or AIDS. So the first thing you'd say is like, well, okay, are you out of your mind? And no, it's just that I have more information than most people. So I'll just go through all of those. In a generation, based on the drugs that we have in market today and the vaccines that are being worked on, it's completely conceivable that the spread of AIDS will stop, and that people who do have AIDS will be moved from, you know, the subsection of, you know, people who die and it becomes AIDS to just people who live with it and who are not affected by it deeply and who are able to maintain it. That's possible in our lifetime. We've already started to have it happen. And so I'm speaking way above my pay grade right now, but in the people I talk to in the HIV space and the research I've done, I've talked to a bunch of people working on it, like this is going to be eradicated or controlled in our lifetime, which is just fabulous and awesome. And it's going to be done through technology and investment in that technology. Then looking at energy, right now we could be energy independent. France is basically, Germany is on the way. All we have to do is put nuclear power back in. Nuclear power is safe. The total number of people who've died from nuclear disasters is like in the hundreds. Like not thousands even, it's like hundreds. The total people who die from coal and from oil spills and from, you know, boilers blowing up in people's houses and all this stuff, like it's tremendous. Just the number of people who like literally get hit by oil trucks flipping on the road is greater by thousands, just from that one type of accident, than nuclear. So if I'm president of the planet, we're doing 50 new nuclear plants in the United States. Like right now, we're breaking ground on them. They're going to be safe. They're going to be small. They're going to be contained. And even in Fukushima, like the nuclear power plant, which was an old design, decades old, was not the problem. It was the wall and where they built it. If that had been built on higher ground or the wall had been 10 feet higher, we would not be talking about Fukushima. That would have shut down. The reactor would have shut down properly. It was just that it got flooded. That was the problem. You know, they lost power and everything. So people don't even understand how great nuclear is compared to other options we have. But there's also solar, which is now becoming amazing. Wind is doing tremendous. So I don't worry about energy. And then if you go to water, water is largely an issue of energy. You can desalinate water. It just costs $5 worth of energy or $3 worth of energy to do it. So if we did it, it would be extremely expensive. But if we solve the energy problem, I mean, if we put a nuclear reactor somewhere between here and Los Angeles, or we put 5 of them, and we pump the water from the ocean through them, we could take the entire desert here and make it into an oasis. It could be from San Francisco to Los Angeles, could be one giant, just amazing, tropical, awesome place. And then food supply is also an energy issue, is also a water issue. So we can solve that. And then all the carbon monoxide in the air is something that's all related, as you guys know, to people burning coal primarily, and to, you know, cows farting and the methane and all that stuff that gets happened when cow, you know, from having too much livestock and unsustainable protein. But we're going to have protein based on crickets and other insects. We're going to have protein based on all kinds of new science. And we're going to have great tasting eggs, and we have, you know, what's it, Hampton Creek and other great people doing soil and other people doing great work on bitty flour, all kinds of stuff that I've had on the program. So food's going to be solved. So we're going to solve food. We're going to solve energy. We're going to solve water. We solve the carbon monoxide, and we could probably even reverse it in the air at some point. You know, like we can make algae that eats more carbon than it does or whatever. So I think all that's going to get solved. Now, what won't get solved, I think, is polarization of wealth and instability because of a lack of employment, instability because of radicalization of people who lack education living in dictatorships run by evil bastards who use religion to manipulate people into blowing up buildings and beating women and cutting people's hands off and caning people and killing and murdering gay people for being gay. Like, that's the shit I worry about. I worry about Pakistan, I worry about Iran, I worry about Saudi Arabia, I worry about all that kind of stuff. That's the kind of stuff that keeps me up at night. And polarization of wealth here. You know, like people in this country are suffering and we're debating the minimum wage and we're debating employment, all this stuff. Like people are suffering. Like we have to like really start to consider some radical concepts around employment. And so I think the best one is we should just make all public servants. We should have them work 4 days a week. We should just take the work week for teachers and for anybody in government. It should be a 4 day work week. It should be a 35 hour work week in 4 days. So it'd be like a, you know, hard week, you know, 8 hours a day or something. No more than that, like 9 hours a day, whatever. Nice big long day, but 4 days a week. And then you hire 20% more people to work in the government. We bloat it. We bloat teachers. So we just add 30% more teachers and we pay teachers 30% more. So like if I'm president, I'm just going to pay every teacher 30% more and I'm going to give them, they're going to work 20% less and we're going to hire 30% more. We're going to like literally just hire tons of teachers and make education better. And you know how we're going to do it? We're going to tax the obscenely rich people more. And if the obscenely rich people wind up paying taxes similar to the French, like I think that's better than there being riots in the street. Listen, I think what they're doing in France in terms of the tax is ridiculous. I don't think it should be 70 or 80%. Like, but we do need to start thinking about what's going to happen to all these, you know, people who can't sustain themselves, you know? And I think the rich people, the truly rich, like, they're getting nervous now. And I hear my richest friends, I'm talking about billionaires, I'm talking about people who have hundreds of millions of dollars. Those people are so concerned about this. The things we talk about, I'm not one of those people, obviously, but I'm not doing that bad. But I talk to them and they're talking about guaranteed minimum income. That was something that if we were talking about just 10 years ago, people were like, well, what's people's motivation? That's anti-society. That's anti-capitalism. It's anti-everything. People are going to stay home. And you would, even a guy like me, I'm 43, maybe I'm getting soft. I would never even consider any of that nonsense. I'd be like, are you crazy? People are going to not have to get up for work. You're going to give people a day off. They're going to have 3 day work weeks. And now I'm like, you know what? I just don't want to see people on the street. I don't want to see people suffering. I don't want to see people not have health care. Like what, if we win so big in this country, if we have Google with $50 billion in the bank and Apple with $100 billion in the bank plus and people in this society here in San Francisco and Los Angeles and New York are doing so well, what will all that victory mean if other people are suffering so much? If children are suffering, it's a very shallow victory. And I think actually that is something that is resonating with the rich in this country, because I don't think anybody anticipated winning as big as they have. Certainly as a kid from Brooklyn, I didn't think I would be able to retire at the age of 43 and not be have to work again. I'm thrilled. I can't believe where I am in life. And so, you know, I think this is something we have to really think about. And listen, I've done okay, but I mean, there's people who've done tremendous. And those people are very worried when they see Occupy Wall Street. I mean, Occupy Wall Street was like a big wake-up call. I mean, it was terribly organized and it was kind of dumb in their approach. But there was some signs of life there that actually had meaning in terms of income disparity. And when they marched on Bloomberg's house, if they had just decided, like if Occupy Wall Street fired up again today, and there were 1,000 people in it, and all they did was go to a rich person's house every day and just camp out there and literally did that every day and said, we're going to camp in front of this rich person's house for a week and then this person's, like that would scare the shit out of rich people. And they would be like, you know what? Give me pay. I'll pay more taxes. Just raise the minimum wage. Whatever we want to give, if we're going to do like global health care, let's do it. I don't know one rich person who doesn't say, I'll pay more taxes, who doesn't say, I will, would love to pay more for schools, who doesn't donate, who hasn't signed the giving pledge. I think actually we're at a tipping point in society. And I think it's going to become a beautiful thing because you have people like Bill Gates who's like, you know what, life is short. I just want to give all this money away and solve as many problems as possible. And then you have everybody, Elon Musk, Zuckerberg, everybody who's, you know, hit the ball out of the park is signing the giving pledge. All that money in our lifetime is going to be given back to society. This is an amazing moment for society. And people are very pessimistic and they have reason to be. I mean, it's not fun to walk around, you know, and see the 6,000 or 7,000 people in San Francisco on the block we're on in the Tenderloin suffering, you know, and the homeless people here, many of which have substance abuse, many of which are mentally ill and who have a diagnosed, you know, mental illness that needs to be treated. Like, and that's why I invested in a company called HandUp that's trying to solve that through technology. A great company, HandUp, that's trying to build software to help the people who manage the relationship with the weakest members of our society, the homeless. Homeless children would be the weakest of the weakest. Maybe we should work on that too. But they're working with those homeless folks to build them a page on the internet where their friends and family can rally around them and try to pull them out of poverty. And it's happening, it's working. One person was addicted to drugs. They put up a page on HandUp. Somebody from who went to high school with them found it. They all got together. They told everybody else on Facebook, hey, look, this is our friend Bill from high school. He's addicted to drugs. He's suffering from depression. He's on the streets of San Francisco. They all got $5,000 together and they put him in to rehab. Like, there's only 7,000 people suffering on the streets of San Francisco. Why the hell can't we solve this? Let's make them each a page. Let's each as groups work with them individually to provide the resources to get them transitioned out of homelessness. As far as I'm concerned, let's make 7,000 apartments that cost $1,000 a month each. I'm not saying we make people like a penthouse suite. I'm talking bare bones. But I would much rather see society just pay for those 7,000 people's apartments and get them off the street than to see people suffering like this. I mean, if you walk around the block from where we are right now on Market and 6th, it is shameful. And it is shameful. Where's that? You have homeless people there. No. No, you guys, I mean, listen, you're socialists, right? We're becoming socialists. Whatever. I mean, I'm obviously playing with language here, but if socialism means you don't let people suffer, well, then in that aspect, I'm a socialist, but maybe I'm a social capitalist, or maybe I'm a capitalist who believes we should let the capitalist system run its course, but along the way, we should make sure that people don't get left behind, right? And so I think that that's what we have to do is just redefine capitalism. I don't think capitalism's bad, but I think that the capitalists who win, they need to look at the big picture and say, do you want to have a revolution in your own fucking country and have the people suffering come to your mansion and your townhouse and break the doors down and light it on fire? Because I think that we're only one or two decades away from that happening. I mean, the people who occupy Wall Street, they did a great job of waking people up to this. And it scared rich people. They were talking about it. And they were agreeing. So we have this very weird political system here that is being hijacked by some group of people. And that group of people has hijacked it to the level at which they believe in this hijacking that, people want guns and they want women to not be able to choose and the rich shouldn't pay taxes. Like, there's this weird perversion that's happened in the American political system where the extremists have taken over. I mean, it's also happened in Israel and other places too, in Palestine, and other places around the world where the extremists seem to hijack the government and all the people who are moderate are like, wait a second, that's not representing me. I don't want to, fire shells and, in order to kill the Hamas, we have to kill everybody else. Like, most of the Jewish people I know were like, yeah, we need to kill Hamas, but I don't know if I agree with how we're doing it. Like, we got to come up with a better solution here. And then most of the people on the other side were like, Hamas doesn't represent us. Like, and then in the United States, we have the same thing. Like, who's anti-choice and who wants to have guns all over the place? Like, nobody. Okay, who are the people who've hijacked the whole system and are shutting our entire political system down over the right to choose and guns? Like, it's very weird what's happened in the United States. And so, but I think it's all going to work out. I don't know. For some reason, I'm very optimistic today.
So how do you make that transition from I think we will all tend to agree with you. And we see very much here in the Valley, a lot of people who tend to agree with you.
Yeah.
But then you go to the East Coast and you go to Boston and you go to New York and you see people who think quite differently and they're more anchored in the old school systems.
Yeah.
How do you make the transition from getting this type of thinking to a government level or to a policy level?
Well, people die. So, like paradigms don't shift, people die. So don't worry about it. Like anybody who thinks the old way, like racist people are dying and racist people are dying and then people are growing up in mixed race families. People used to hide the gay kids in their family by pushing them to the priesthood. When I was a kid in Brooklyn, like if you were gay, it was like, you really should become a priest. Like we can hide you over there. Like Italian and Irish were like, yeah, that's a safe place to put you so you don't actually get murdered on the street for being gay. Because that's what these poor moms would do. They would see these people getting beaten in the streets of Greenwich Village, and they'd be like, oh my God, my son's gay. He's going to be beaten to death. Where can I put him that's going to be safe? Put him into the priesthood, you know, like we're going to hide him over there. Like it's shameful. And now it's like everybody's out and we all have gay people in our family. And the idea of being homophobic is just so ridiculous that young people can't even perceive it. Then in Iran, like, I don't know what percentage, 70, 80% of people are under the age of 25. Like they just want Facebook and Twitter and video games and smartwatches and like, they want to drink and they want to watch DirecTV. Like they don't care about this crazy radical bullshit, you know, that the elders are preaching. So like, we didn't have to go into Iraq. We don't have to go into Iran. We just have to sit back and watch it. You know, Cuba, Fidel is going to pass on. You think his kids are going to miss the opportunity to make that the greatest destination in the world? No, they're going to make that the greatest vacation destination for Americans ever. Capitalism, greed, opportunity, whatever you want to call it. Like North Korea, I'm not so sure. But Iran, Saudi Arabia, those young people are going to run that country. It's all going to transition. The people in Boston who are old school, who cares? They'll be dead. You know, like I'm very optimistic today. It may change tomorrow, but I'm optimistic actually. And I'm optimistic because I think if you look at entrepreneurship, it really is driving people to think about how can things change for the better. And it could be something small like getting a cab. It could be something big like nuclear energy, you know, everything in between. All of these things are valid pursuits. You know, Twitter was this like little tiny idea that people dismissed as stupid and basic, like, oh, we're going to have a blog post and we'll take away the blog and we'll just leave the headline. Like, that's stupid. I said that's stupid, actually. Yeah, I was those people. And it turns out, like, you know what? The fact that not everybody can write a blog post, it's like not intimidating to write 140 characters, so everybody does it. So you got everybody writing. And now, well, these people who can't write are like, can I get another sentence? Like, I'm sort of training the world how to write two sentences now. Everybody's writing one. Maybe someday we'll all write two in Twitter. But it's created this incredible opportunity for people around the world to just say how they feel and to star and retweet how other people feel, right, and amplify. And it's creating these great moments. Like, we have this horrible injustice going on here in Ferguson, and now it's documented on Twitter to a level that nobody can deny. We have a huge issue in this country, in the South, in some other places, you know, where, like, people are not treated fairly and they're shot apparently in the face, you know, with their hands up. Like, we can't have this. We can't live in this society. Like, and now it's all being documented on video, on YouTube, on Vine, on Instagram, it's Twitter. It's all documented. You can't deny what's been documented. It's one of the great things. We're living in a time of massive change. People who are against gay marriage, people who are for gay marriage, whoop, lines crossed in the last 5 years. People who are against legalization of marijuana, people who are for legalization of marijuana, whoop, crossed in the last 5 years. And you're just going to go through every single one of these things that you didn't think would change in your lifetime, and they're all going to cross. All going to cross. Universal health care. It's going to cross. Boom. We'll get there. All right.
Thank you very much.
This has been awesome. Great talking to you. Go change the world. Make some money, too. And then give it away. What's that? Very good. Which one was better? Who was the other?
First, you're just talking about the typical investor stuff. This X, that X.
I said,
and this was a different conversation we had in the last 20 minutes.
Into the microphone. You have to say it into the microphone. So you can get it on the camera.
We've seen two Jasons today.
Okay.
So first, the regular investing, it was only talking this X and that X, and I'm going to make money and find the best entrepreneur and the whole great story, but also a little bit like, oh, okay, we've heard that from other fantastic people.
Yeah.
Inspiring people. And the other Jason that is caring and having a vision on some of the challenges of the world.
Yeah.
Being realistic, not being like up in the air. That's cool. Thanks for your time.
Oh, yeah. It's a pleasure. I will come to Singularity. Yes, I will come. All right. Listen, we went over. Okay. Thank you to WeWork and Silicon Valley Bank. We'll see you next time.